Good morning. Today's lecture is about early Africa and Islam. And first thing I'm going to talk about is Africa. And I don't know if you actually realize how big Africa is, so I put a map here for you. I know it sounds kind of ironic to say or dumb to say even, but Africa is not a country, it's actually a continent. You'd be amazed at how many people get that mixed up. Africa is made up of dozens of different countries. It's really big. It's 12 million plus square miles and over 1.25 billion people now. So here are just some other places in the world that will fit inside of Africa. And you can see that there's still space left over. So just know that Africa is a lot bigger than you probably realized. Also, in case you don't remember, one of the very first lectures, in fact, I think the very first one, we talked about the out of Africa theory. So early humans who were hunters and gatherers, they came from the grasslands and the savannas of southern and eastern Africa, and then eventually moved north into different parts of the world. The agricultural revolution begins in Africa. On a technicality, the Middle East is part of Africa because it's part of the African continental plate. And Africa is going to have a lot of different agricultural crops, anything from millet to sorghum to bananas, sugar, coconuts, you name it. There's a lot of different things grown in Africa. Ancient Egypt, that's Africa too. One of the first settlements, or one of the first large-scale civilizations of human history, was ancient Egypt. And another refresher, you know, the first settlements in Egypt are somewhere between 5000 and 5200 BC. You have the Egyptian people spreading along the both sides of the Nile River. You have the Old Kingdom, the Middle Kingdom, the New Kingdom. You've got Ra and Amun, and the pyramids, the Sphinx, you name it. And then, of course, we have hieroglyphics, which are going to be created that tells us all about the ancient Egyptians. Something that I haven't really mentioned before, but I'm going to now, is ancient Ethiopia. Ethiopia used to be known as the Kingdom of Aksum or the Kingdom of Kush. And it's also along the Nile River, but it's the Blue Nile. The Blue Nile, remember, is where most of the water comes from for the Nile River, but the White Nile is longer. The Blue Nile is going to be where the Kingdom of Aksum was located. What's really interesting about Aksum is it used to be a colony of the Kingdom of Saba. The Kingdom of Saba is better known as Sheba. The Queen of Sheba actually was a real person at one point in time. And Aksum, or Ethiopia as it's known today, was one of the first places outside the Middle East to convert to Christianity, and it does that around the year 300. The Sahara is probably the best known part of Africa. That is the giant desert that stretches from east to west across the entire northern part. We don't know why Africa started to dry out. The technical term for this is desiccation, and Africa started to become a desert somewhere around 5 to 6,000 BC. There was climate change, and ever since then, the Sahara has been growing bigger and bigger and bigger. Even today, the Sahara is growing bigger, and there's an active plan in place to combat the expansion of the Sahara. Many of the countries along the southern border of the Sahara have been planting trees and stopping the Sahara from growing, and it turns out it's actually starting to work. The city of Carthage, which we talked about with ancient Rome, or if you watched that video on ancient Rome, you would have seen the Punic Wars between Rome and Carthage. The city of Carthage is like the focal point of the Saharan trade. Places further in the desert, like Carthage is going to be where all of that trade centers, and then it is sent to other parts of the world. Carthage is not the only city that's located in the Sahara. Timbuktu is a real place. Marrakesh still exists today. They recently had a really bad earthquake. And there are Bedouins, people who travel throughout the Sahara all the time, then and today. Eastern and Southern Africa are both very important. There are two large cultural groups that live in them. There is a group known as the Khoisan, and there's a group known as the Bantu. There are different people who identify as Bantu, different people who identify as Khoisan. But with the Bantu, it's a set of over 450 languages that are somewhat understandable between each other. It's kind of like English today. You can go to many different countries and they speak English, but there are different dialects of English. Or maybe even a better way to put this is with the Romance languages. Italian, Spanish, Romance, French, Romanian, and a couple other things are all related. While you may not be able to understand everything when they're spoken, you can understand some of the items between those languages, and you can definitely read them if you look at the words long enough. That's kind of what Bantu is like. The word Bantu means people, and they have this really cool thing in their language called reduplication. Piga, P-I-G-A, means to hit or strike. Piga, piga, means to strike repeatedly. And today, the Bantu language, there's about 350 to 400 million people that speak it. The other big language group is known as the Khoisan, and that's the Click language. And somewhere around half a billion, like 500 million people speak Khoisan, or a dialect of it. And depending where the click is in the word, it can change the meaning of the word. It can be a consonant, a syllable, a placeholder. So it's a very complicated language to learn. And then Greece. When we talked about Greece, a lot of ancient Greece had its basis in Africa. Like, for example, when Alexander the Great takes over the world, he makes Alexandria in Egypt the headquarters of Greek culture. Ptolemy steals Alexander's body, according to tradition, hides it in Egypt because that's how important Egypt was to ancient Greece. The language of the Greeks was Phoenician, which was a culture that was in the Middle East and then became part of the culture of Carthage. The Pillars of Heracles are in northern Africa. The Caves of Heracles are in northern Africa. The story of Andromeda happens in what would be today Ethiopia. So whether it's the Hellenic world with ancient Sparta, ancient Athens, or the Hellenistic world of Alexander the Great, both are very closely related to Africa. The Roman Empire considered northern Africa a completely Roman territory. Carthage, as I mentioned before, it's in northern Africa. That's a huge part of Roman history. The Punic Wars are what changed Rome from an empire from a republic to an empire. And these northern African provinces, that's where the grain, the food that feeds the Romans, comes from. Even Christianity. I know we haven't talked about Christianity yet. I'm going to talk about that in a couple of lectures. But Christianity is based in northern Africa. The so-called Holy Land, that's on the African continent. The apostles are going to spread Christianity throughout North Africa during the first century AD. There is a different form of Christianity that's formed in Egypt and Ethiopia known as Coptic Christianity. In Coptic Christianity, the most basic way to understand it, they believe that Jesus was human and he did not become godlike or divine until after his death. In contrary, most Christian denominations, they believe that Jesus was human and divine at the same time. So it's a small difference, but it's a significant difference between mainstream Christianity and Coptic Christianity. Some of the earliest important people of the Christian church are from Africa. Augustine of Hippo, he claims that Rome was sacked. Rome fell in the year 410 AD because it was a non-Christian city. All right. Islam is based in Africa, and Islam is going to become one of the major religions of the world. Islam is founded in the city of Mecca. Most people know that, but the reason why may not be apparent. Mecca was this crossroads of different trading routes, and so a lot of people went through Mecca thousands of different people, hundreds of different religions were represented there. And the idea of tourism is going to be what keeps Mecca going. Because of it, Mecca is going to be not just a center of trade, it's going to be a center of religion too. Islam is founded by Muhammad. A lot of people know that, but you may not know who he is. Muhammad was born somewhere around 570 AD. He was raised in Mecca. He was steeped in these different cultures, these different religions. He is going to be abandoned or adopted, I guess I should say. He grows up. He marries a woman named Khadija, I think, in the age of 25. And then somewhere around the year 610, he's going to go to a cave outside of Mecca known as Mount Hira, where he is going to be visited by one of the archangels. It's also really important to know that Islam is not a new religion. It is completely based on an earlier religion known as Judaism. And before you say, wait a minute, Christianity is based on Judaism too. There are five pillars, five pieces of the Islamic faith. One of those pillars is Shahada. There is only one God. In most Christian denominations, the idea of God is split up into the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Ghost. But in Islam, you don't have that. The deity of Islam is much closer to the deity in Judaism. Judaism, it's the deity is known as Yahweh. In Islam, the deity is known as Allah. It's the same word, just pronounced differently. Same thing with Jehovah, same word, just pronounced differently. Also, Christ is recognized, but Christ was just a prophet in Islam. The third of four great prophets, Moses, David, Jesus, Muhammad. Prayer, Salat. A devout Muslim is supposed to pray five times a day to Mecca. And it's early morning, mid-afternoon, late afternoon, and then nighttime before bed. There's tithing or zakat. Zakat is a tax that all Muslims must pay. It's seen as a loan to Allah that's going to be repaid in the afterlife. It's very similar to how in a Christian church, the plate is passed and money is put into the plate during certain periods of the service. There's fasting or psalm. In Islam, it's the month of Ramadan. During the month of Ramadan, there's no food, drink, or medicine, or even like physical pleasure during the sun being up. When the sun is down, there are certain foods, certain drinks you can have, but it's very limited. In Judaism, you might think of that like Passover. In Christianity, you may think of that as Lent, giving things up for Lent. And then there's Hajj, pilgrimage. Every devout Muslim is expected to go to Mecca one time in their life. Now you might say, wait a minute, you don't find that in Christian religion. It's because it's mostly removed. But at one point in time, a Christian was supposed to either visit Rome or Jerusalem in their lifetime. I want you to also notice jihad is not part of Islam. That's topical today concerning what's going on in Israel. Jihad, holy war, it's not part of Islam. That is people corrupting Islam for their own political uses. There are two books of importance in Islam. There's the Quran, which means recitation. Those are supposed to be the words of Allah as revealed to Muhammad. And it's based largely on the Torah. And then there's the Hadith, which is somebody else documenting Muhammad and documenting Muhammad's words and actions throughout his life. We've got the Hijra. In 622, Muhammad is going to be forced out of Mecca to a nearby city named Medina. It's about 200 miles north of Mecca. The reason Muhammad is chased out is because his view on religion was not welcome at the time. Remember, there are hundreds of religions represented in Mecca, and Muhammad is trying to change all of that into being a monotheistic religion. So he's basically chased out. And for about 8 years, he keeps telling his opinion, his views on religion, and he gains more and more followers until around the year 630, he has enough followers where he starts marching back to Mecca, where he takes Mecca by force. So suddenly, Muhammad's not just the leader of a religion, he's going to become the leader of a kingdom as well. Now, yes, the kingdom he creates is based on Islam, but that's not because Islam told him to do it. They're two different things. Remember, jihad is not part of Islam. Now, what happens after Muhammad? In the year 632, Muhammad dies, and one of his relatives, Abu Bakr, is chosen to be the next leader. And he's not just the leader of the Islamic faith. He's going to become the commander of this army, this kingdom. He's going to become the head of the kingdom, and he becomes the supreme judge of the kingdom too. So he's the leader of the faith, and he's the political leader as well. In the next 2 years, Abu Bakr is going to unite most of the people in the area under the flag of Islam. And in trying to create a larger kingdom, Abu Bakr and many of his successors are going to start conquering territories around Mecca. And wherever these armies go, Islam is going to spread as well. Now, there are three basic divisions of Islam. There's the Shiites, the Sunnis, and the Sufis. And this is just the basic difference. There's a lot of nuance between them. But Shiites, they believe that Ali, who is Muhammad's son-in-law, is the true successor of Muhammad. A Shiite believes that Muhammad was a prophet of Allah, and Shiites only believe the laws as they're written within the Quran. Sunnis, on the other hand, they believe that Abu Bakr was the successor to Muhammad, and they believe not just in the written laws, but also in the actions Muhammad did through his lifetime. Now, the Sunni faith, or the Sunni branch of Islam, was considered for most of history to be the mainstream belief, but in recent times, I'm talking maybe the last 20 years, Shiites, even though they're often the smaller number of followers, is slowly becoming the primary belief system. Last but not least, we have Sufis. And Sufis, I honestly don't understand them very much, but they are kind of like mystics. They believe that all of the best tributes of Allah were manifested in Muhammad, and that if you study Muhammad and if you live a life similar to Muhammad, that gets you as close to understanding and knowing Allah as possible. Sufis also believe that Muhammad was a supreme human being, and that Muhammad was like the master of all creatures on earth. Now, I mentioned that there is a kingdom that's developed out of this. So we get this Islamic civilization that slowly takes over North Africa and the Middle East. And the cities of Baghdad and Cordoba are two of the best known Islamic cities. Baghdad has over 1 million residents. It's 4 times as large as Constantinople. Cordoba, one of the largest cities in Europe. It's got one of the largest mosques in all of Islam. It seats over 5,000 people. It has a library that holds thousands of books. And it's a very well set up city that has become like an international place of significance, I guess I can say. Islamic culture is going to facilitate trade between East and West. Islamic culture is going to be tolerant of Christians and Jews. Christians and Jews are seen as people of the book, so they are going to be tolerated and protected. However, Christians and Jews are expected to pay taxes and live under Islamic law. If you're a heathen, though, if you are not a Christian, Jew, or Muslim, then you can be forcibly converted according to Islamic tradition. Women are secluded and mostly kept in the home in this civilization. Men are allowed up to 4 wives, but they have to be able to financially support each of those 4. And then Muslims are going to be keepers of medicine, science, philosophy, and a lot of what we know today based in those three subjects comes from what the Muslims were able to keep. Islamic civilization didn't really have a, quote, dark age like Europe did. All right, I think that's going to be it for this. I'm not going to play this video because that would make sense to make you watch a video in a video. But if you want to watch this on YouTube, it's called What Happened to the Islamic Empire. It's done by Ted Ed, the makers of TED Talks. And I appreciate you watching. Thank you so much. We will talk to you next week. Goodbye.